Dear friends, this day I want to talk to you about the torn veil and its significance. To bank my message on a particular verse, I want to refer to Matthew's Gospel 27th chapter, verses from 50 to 54. Jesus was crucified. He cried out with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth quaked, and the rocks were split, and the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised, and coming out of the graves after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. So when the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and the things that happened, they feared greatly, saying, "This was truly the Son of God." Dear friends, when Jesus died on the cross, the veil of the temple was torn into two. When Jesus died, he cried out with a loud voice. "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit," and yielded up his spirit. When he died, the veil in the temple was torn into two. Then the earthquake was there, the rocks were split, and graves of many saints were open. Who were those saints? I believe they were Old Testament saints. Their graves were open, their bodies rose. It was all dust. The bodies were prepared. Bodies were rather recreated. They sat there. When Jesus rose again, they came out of the life. Life came into them. Now, Jesus is the first fruit of resurrection, and all others shall be resurrected in their own order. Jesus is the first person who died and rose again. So, this was what happened. And when these things happened, the centurion said, "Truly, this was the Son of God." Now, I want to talk to you about the torn veil and its significance. When God created Adam and Eve, they were created in the image of God. They could look at God every day. During the cool of the day, I believe cool of the day means morning and evening, God used to visit them and God used to talk to Adam and Eve. There was no veil in between. There was no barrier in between. They could talk to God freely. But once sin came, veil came, the partition came, separation came. They had to be chased away from the Garden of Eden. And they were not able to go and take the fruit of the tree of life again. So the veil came. Now, God's heart was longing for humanity. God wanted to reach out to man and then show his glory to the people. So later, many years later, God instructed Moses to establish a tabernacle. He wanted to tabernacle with the people. So in the tabernacle, outer court was there, holy place was there, holy of holies was there. Between holy of holies and the holy place, there is a curtain. And the curtain was prepared in a very beautiful way. And God told Moses, Exodus 26:31, "You shall make a veil woven of blue, purple, and scarlet thread, and fine woven linen. It shall be woven with an artistic design of cherubim." Angels' designs were there. And it was called as poriketh in Hebrew. This particular word is not used anywhere for any hanging. It is so special because it is separating the holy place from the Holy of Holies. Once in a year, the high priest used to go into the Holy of Holies with the blood of a lamb to offer atonement for himself and the sin of the people. Suppose the man goes there and dies there, nobody else can go and retrieve the body because only the high priest can go into the Holy of Holies. And just before the curtain, there is to be an altar of incense. A holy incense will be kept there and it will be burned. So surrounded by the smoke, he will go in. Once in a year, he used to go. What they used to do was, when he goes in, suppose if he dies because of old age, or maybe if he dies because of sin, his body cannot be taken by anybody else. So when they go in, they used to tie a chain to his leg. So if the body falls down, they'll pull his body out. This was the Shekinah glory of God was there. And behind the veil, this was what was happening. So the Lord tabernacled with them and God was going with them. Now, the third veil we see was in the temple that Solomon built. So the veil that was in the tabernacle that Moses built, it was 10 cubit by 10. 1 cubit is this amount, this distance. So 10 by 10 cubit. And now later when Solomon built the temple, he had built it in an enormous way, in a beautiful way. And the veil of Solomon's temple was 20 by 20 cubits. And he made the veil of blue, purple, crimson, and fine linen, and wove cherubim into it. He followed what was already in the tabernacle that Moses established. King Solomon and all the congregation of Israel were assembled with him, and were with him before the ark, sacrificed sheep and oxen. Then the priests brought in the ark of the covenant of the Lord to its place, into the inner sanctuary of the temple, to the most holy place, under the wings of the cherubim. Now, at that night, when Solomon was sleeping, the Lord God appeared before him and said, "If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will visit them, I will bless them." And then he said, "I have chosen this place and sanctified this house. My name will be there forever. Mine eyes and my heart shall be there perpetually." Dear friends, the Holy of Holies, that before that the veil was, this was a very important place in the Jewish culture. They knew about the Holy of Holies and of the Shekinah glory that was behind that. Later what happened was Solomon and others, people of Israel, sinned against God. The glory of God left. And later, Ezra rebuilt the temple. Ezra rather built the second temple. The glory was there, but it was not as glorious as it had been in the time of Solomon. Now, later what happened was, Ezra's temple also was going into jeopardy. It was getting destroyed. Later we see Herod building the temple for God. Now, I want to tell a few points about Herod's temple. Herod the Great was a person who was very evil, and he was a half Jew, and they resented him because of the Idumean ancestry that he had. But he was a very wicked man. He killed two of his wives and three sons, and he put to death 46 leading members of the Sanhedrin, that is the Jewish assembly or council. He was one who killed all the male infants when Jesus was born. Augustus Caesar said, "It is better to be Herod's pig rather than his son." Pig is hus in Greek, and son is huios. So Augustus used to say, "It is better to be Herod's hus rather than his huios." He was such an evil man. Now, he died because of intestinal cancer. He wanted the leaders of the Jewish people to be killed so that people will cry, not for him, but at least for the other people. But they were not killed. Now, this man was beginning to build the temple, Herod's temple. It was built so magnanimously, and altogether they took 46 years for him to build it. But the problem is they had a veil. The veil was 40 cubits into 20 cubits, very big veil. Listen to me, this veil was prepared in a different way. It was 4 inches thick, or maybe hand breadth. It was very thick, very thick. And it was prepared in 72 pieces, and they knit them together. It was so heavy, 300 priests were needed to wash it, take it down and wash it. If two horses were tied at the two bottom ends of this veil, it cannot tear it. It was so, so strong. But the problem was, it was a Babylonian curtain. And in that, they were able to see signs of zodiac. Zodiac is a diagram used by astrologers to represent the position of planets and stars to calculate the influence of planets on a person's life in order to write horoscope. This was there in the tabernacle that was established by Moses, and also Solomon's temple. The veil had cherubim there. Angelic figures were there, but here it was only zodiac sign. Why did Herod build the temple? He wanted to cover his sin. Now, inside the Holy of Holies, within the veil, nothing was there. No Ark of the Covenant was there. Nothing was there. No glory of God was there. He wanted to cover everything. Now, dear friends, when Jesus died on the cross, this is what we read. Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Then, behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. As I told you, even horses cannot tear this veil because it is so thick. But when Jesus died, it was torn from top to bottom. The veil of Herod's temple must be broken. It must be torn apart so that certain things could be understood. Now, usually that was considered to be a temple. So one point is, the veil was torn so that anybody can go in. As I told you initially, only the high priest can go into the temple. Others cannot go. High priest can go once in a year with blood in his hand to make atonement for himself and the others. But here, God, when Jesus died, no more blood should be shed for remission of sin, because Jesus' blood is enough. And also the veil was trembled, making people understand that Jesus has paved the way for man to go into the presence of God. Hebrews 9:24 says, "For Christ has not entered in the holy places made with hands," because Jesus was born in the tribe of Judah, not in the tribe of Levi. The Aaronic priesthood, they came from the tribe of Levi. Jesus was not born in the tribe of Levi. So he was not able to go into the holy place of Solomon's temple later the Herod's temple, he was not expected to go. So the writer to Hebrews says, for Christ has not entered the holy places made with hands, which are copies of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for all of us. He pierced the veil of his own body, paving the way for us to go into the presence of God. Hebrews 10:22 says, therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he consecrated for us through the veil, that is his flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Hebrews 7:25-26 says, therefore he is also able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for us who go to God through him. Now, dear friends, I tell you, with the help of the Holy Spirit, when we go to God through Jesus, he is there to pray for us. What is the meaning of torn veil? Now, when Jesus died, the veil was torn so that we have entry into the presence of God. Anytime, anybody, anywhere can reach out to God and have an audience with the Lord Jesus Christ. So the Word of God says, let us boldly enter the Holy of Holies into the new and living way. So the glory of God is there. You can have access to the presence of God. You would have heard about Dr. Billy Graham, who was a great man of God. One Saturday, after praying for the message that he would have to deliver on Sunday, he went to sleep and he had a dream. In the dream, he found himself going to the presence of God in heaven. It's a dream. And as he was trying to enter into the throne room of God, God looked at him with a very strong face and said, what do you want? So he stood there and he said, I want to talk to you. He said, I don't know you. So Dr. Billy Graham was going away. Suddenly Jesus came and said, hey, Billy, what is happening? Why are you here? Then he said, Father is not allowing me to go to him. Jesus took hold of Dr. Billy Graham and entered into the throne room of God and said, Father, he obeys me. He is my servant. I tell you, friends, without Jesus, nobody can go to God. Now, when Jesus died, the veil of the Herod's temple was torn into two. Now, the second meaning for this veil to be torn is exposure of false religion. As I told you, zodiac signs were there, nothing to do with God, no cherubims were there. It was open to make people understand nothing is inside, no glory of God was inside. The veil had to be broken. Now, dear friends, St. Paul, when he wrote to Corinthians, he speaks about a veil in the heart of the people. People of Israel, when they were reading the Old Testament, there was a veil in the heart, before their heart, a barrier in their heart. They could not understand. So that veil had to be removed. So even now, when so-called Christians read the Bible, they are not able to understand. They value the things of this world and finances and money more than the presence of God. So there is a veil before their heart. So Romans 1:28-32, the Word of God says, even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do all evil things greedily. See, when people are not willing to go to God, understand their own condition, understand what God has prepared for them, they have a veil on their heart. And God said, these people will not reform. God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do all evil greedily. A few years back, I went to IIT here in Chennai in their prayer cell for a meeting. After the message, I gave time for the students to interact with me and ask questions. One student asked a question, Uncle, will God forgive the sins that I plan to commit? See, look at the irony of that question. Will God forgive my sins that I'm planning to commit? Okay, during that weekend maybe he was planning to commit some sin. He wants God to forgive. Well, God is willing to forgive any sin provided there is repentance. But when people take light of God's word and continue to be in sin, it is very difficult for them to come out. Very difficult for them to pray. Very difficult for them to humble themselves and repent for their sins. If they repent really, God will definitely forgive. So we must understand whether there is a veil in our hearts. How many of you are having a veil before your heart so that the word of God is not able to penetrate? Now, another point that I see is in homes, between husband and wife, there is a veil. What the husband does, wife doesn't know. What the wife does, husband doesn't know. One family came to me for prayer. That husband was having an illegal relationship with a woman. And when he heard my message, He came to me for counseling. I was able to help him. Then he understood his wife was having another problem. She was beginning a chit fund and she entered into a lot of financial problems to the tune of few lakhs. So there was no clarity between husband and wife, no transparency between husband and wife. So there is a veil in between husband and wife. And there is veil between parents and children. Many parents do not know what has happened in the life of the children. They are hiding things. Veils must be broken. Veils must be broken. So this is what God wants us to do. Now, dear friends, when there is a veil, blindness is there. We are not able to see what God has prepared for us. The veil must be torn apart. How to do it? St. Paul says, nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. 2 Corinthians 3:16. Turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Understand, one day the veil is going to be totally removed. Now we may put on a facade as if we are big, as if we are somebody and great, great, great holy people. A day is going to come, the Lord is going to lift all the veils. It is imperative that we listen to God's word today, now, and turn to God. When we turn to God, the veil shall be taken. We shall see God as He is. We will see in our heart what God has in store for us. We will see what is in our heart. We will see what God has prepared for us. We will be able to appear before God. See, the throne of God is always there. The mercy seat is open there. So the word of God says, when we face problems, let us go boldly to the throne of God. There is no veil in the presence of God. But when people put on veil, to remove the veil, they are led to turn to God with all their hearts. So, dear friend, the turn to the Lord, the veil shall be removed. Allow the Holy Spirit to work in our hearts for deeper revelation. See, sometimes when people come into the presence of God, they have an understanding of God's blessings, they receive it, they stop with that. When you obey the word of God more and more, the Spirit of God will be able to tell you deeper things of God, deeper things of God. Not bombastic revelation on the plateau of great miracles. I'm not telling that. Personally, in your own heart, as you grow in the Spirit of God, you will understand your weaknesses more, your flesh signature more. You'll be cautious on that area. You will be careful to remove all the veil so that the power of God can touch you. So allow the Holy Spirit to work in our hearts for deeper revelation. Long to be more close to God, long to understand God more and more. In John's Gospel 17 chapter, Jesus prayed, Father, knowing you and your Son Jesus Christ is eternal life. Knowledge of God is eternal life. It's epignosis, a deeper personal knowledge of the Lord God. We have the Word of God in our hands. Are we really praying and revering God's Word? I tell you, my dear friends, there are people who are not obeying God's Word. There was a man who used to go to a particular church. And the preacher was a liberal theologian. He used to take the Bible and say, Jonah, he was swallowed by a whale and he lived for 3 days. Ah, I can't believe it. I don't want to believe it. So this man will come, take the Bible, tear off that particular book from the Bible. So whenever this theologian used to preach something negative about the Bible, he'll come and tear it off. Days went on. This man was in deathbed. So he called for the pastor to come and talk to him and pray for him. When the pastor came there, he did not bring his Bible. And he said, come on, let me have your Bible. This man gave a Bible. When he opened it, nothing was inside. All torn pages. Torn pages. Then he told the pastor, this is the effect of your preaching. Now, dear friends, the Word of God is given to us. We must be in a position to read God's Word, meditate upon God's Word, let the Spirit of God work in and through us. Then there would not be any veil in our own life. We will be able to see God in a deeper way. Now, we see God's glory as in a mirror. St. Paul says, we see God's glory in a mirror. Then we'll be able to see Him face to face. Now, commission that has come from the torn veil. When the centurion saw these things, he said, truly, this was the Son of God. Many people do not understand. Now, I tell you, this centurion who saw all these things happen, the graves opening and the rocks being rent, he saw all these things, he was able to say, truly, this was the Son of God. After the death and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, he was the first person to say, truly, this was the Son of God. It was a great revelation that he had. So before the broken veil, before the torn veil, you will have deeper understanding of God and His plans. It is said that Joseph of Arimathea was a disciple of the Lord Jesus for fear of Jews. He didn't want to come out and declare that he was following Jesus. He was a secret believer of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, when Jesus died, we see Joseph of Arimathea coming boldly to Pilate, asking for the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea, they buried the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. How could he do that? He was a secret disciple. Now, how could he do that? My dear friends, I tell you, there is a legend that says, when Jesus was buried, Joseph of Arimathea was trying to hide in the temple precinct, not in the Holy of Holies, but outside. As he was there, suddenly there was an earthquake, and he saw the veil rent. When the veil was rent, he could see the glory of God. At that time, glory of God had come there to make him understand about the rent veil, and said, "What are you doing here? My son is hanging on the cross. Go and bury his body." And people say, because of this revelation from God that came through the rent-torn veil, he was able to go boldly to Pilate and crave for the body of Jesus and gave him a decent burial. So, dear friends, in our hearts, this veil must be torn. In future, all veils will be torn away. If you look at Revelation 20th chapter, verses from 11 to 15, "And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, and from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which was the book of life. The dead were judged out of the things which were written in the books, according to their own deeds. The death and hell were cast into the lake of fire." This is the second death. "And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." My dear friends, I tell you, this is going to happen one day. We may put on a mask as if we are good. Many believers have a mask over their face. Not that we'll have to go and tell everybody what is in our heart. I'm not telling that. But what is needed is we have to answer God one day. How are we living today? If we judge ourselves, we will not be judged. We all make mistakes, inclusive of me. But what we need to understand is, we'll have to go to God and say, "Lord, please forgive me. Cleanse me. Make me whole." Then we will not be expected to stand before the judgment seat of God on that day. On that day, all the people who are having all masks will be torn away. All veils will be torn away. And how are we going to attend? How are we going to face that challenge on that day? And also, the torn veil has another implication: hope of eternal glory. St. Paul, when he wrote to Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 13:12, he says, "For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall be known just as I am also known." Now, we were born in this miserable world. Who are we? We never had the likeness that Adam and Eve had when they were created. After sin, the likeness of God or the image of God is totally gone. Totally gone. It was not actually, God did not create man in a way of cloning. No. Only a shadow or a semblance was upon Adam and Eve. That was gone. They even forgot how the glory of God had been. Now, St. Paul says, after the revelation of God's word, after the Holy Spirit came, he says, we see the image of God in a glory, image of God in a nice way. Dimly we see it, and that day we will see face to face. Writes in his epistle, 1 John 3rd chapter, beginning from the first verse, he says, "What manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the children of God. We know that we are the children of God, and we do not know what we are going to be in future. But when we see Jesus, we shall be like him. And he who has his hope in him purifies him as he is pure." This is what we should do, so that when Jesus comes back, there will be no veil that should be removed from our face. We will see Jesus without any hindrance. We will see him as he is. My dear friends, there is great joy in looking at the glory of God. Anybody, anywhere can reach out to God. The veil has been rent. Though it was so thick, it was rent. Anybody can reach out to God because Jesus has gone before the presence of God, going through the veil of his own body. He offered his body for our sins so we can reach out to him. My dear friends, are we longing to come closer to God? Let us understand where we are. Are we putting on a facade between husband and wife, between parents and children, between pastor and the church? Are they having a veil? Let us go to God. St. Paul says, when they turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. There was a little orphan boy who had no place to stay. He was staying in the streets. And one day, he used to go to a shop, look through the glass. Eatables will be there, toys will be there. He would not be in a position to go and buy them. He used to look at them, I mean, long for them, and come away disappointed. One day, as he was looking at a glass in a shop and coming away, a car came and hit him. He was hospitalized. It so happened, a godly couple, when they went to this hospital, they saw this 12-year-old boy. They had a 12-year-old boy who died. So when they saw this boy, they took pity on him. They had compassion upon him. They spent money to for his treatment. Then they brought him to their own house. They took him to their son's bedroom and said, "This is for you." He looked here and there, and a lot of toys were there, eatables were there, playthings were there. And he said, "All for me?" They said, "It's all for you." And he turned to them and said, "What do you expect from me?" They said, "You love us back." He ran here and there, touched on this toys and said, "There's no glass in between. Previously, when he was an orphan, there was glass in between. Now the glass is removed. The veil is removed." I tell you, friends, bank on the word of God. Long for the presence of God. One day we are going to see him. Till such times, let us have a longing for the Lord. Let there be no veil between us and God. Let the glory of God come upon even now. Shall we look to God in prayer? Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, and praise you for this joy of listening to your voice. When you died on the cross, the veil of Herod's temple was torn into two. From top to bottom, it was work of God, paving the way for anybody to go into the Holy of Holies, to see the Shekinah glory, to see the presence of God, to enjoy the presence of God, to grow in His own likeness. I thank you, Lord, and praise you for the joy in understanding these things, O God. I pray for the people who have been here listening to your voice today. Lay your hands upon them and bless them, O God. Let every broken home be totally delivered, O Lord. Let there be no barrier in between husband and wife. Let there be no veil in between husband and wife. Let there be no veil between parents and children. Let them understand what they are. Let them come to you, O God. Let them turn to you so that the veil shall be taken. I pray that you may bless everyone, O Lord. Let the grace of God continue to be in the hearts of everyone. I give you all the glory. I give you all the glory. Let me have the joy in serving you till the last breath. In Jesus' almighty name I pray.